Well, good morning, friends. This is Brother Mike back on the podcast, Sunday morning, 9 o'clock Mountain Time, 11 o'clock on the East Coast. Thanks for joining. Joining the Deep Things of God with Brother Mike. Today's Bible study is going to be fascinating. The secret to answered prayer. Most Christians don't understand how to get their prayers answered and couldn't figure it out if you hit them over the head with a baseball bat. But today, no bats will be used. I'll just explain it in layman's terms. And from this day forward, you're going to have a very changed spiritual life. If you need to get a hold of me, please go to send me an email at mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Please go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com. Please remember we have two live deliverance services every week on Zoom, Tuesday nights at 6 p.m. Mountain Time. Wednesday nights, 6 p.m. Mountain Time. We have two live services every week at the Arizona Deliverance Center. We're downtown on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Rd. It's the red brick building. Thursday and Friday nights at 7 p.m. Mountain Time. Both those services are broadcast live on our streaming channels. We have several of them. Our main one is on YouTube. Go to youtube.com/houseofhealingaz and you're there. Both services are live. Today's podcast is being broadcast on twitch.tv and on my Facebook page, Michael W. Smith, and on my Facebook group, Hardcore Christianity. Thank you for tuning in today. The secrets to answered prayer. Can you imagine that? Wow. That's a tough one, isn't it? Actually, it isn't. Check this out. Jesus had shared with the people the number one parable he ever spoke. He explained the entire gospel message in one parable, the parable of the sower. Everybody's read that parable, and it's the greatest of all parables. After he got done with that parable, his disciples were confused because they heard him say, Jesus said, whoever has an ear to hear, let him hear. It's a weird statement. And the disciples came to him later, it says, and they said to Jesus, why do you speak to them in parables? Well, remember, the people that were hearing the gospel for the first time, illustrated by the parable of the sower, the Greek word is parabole. It means an illustration, something you're using a metaphor, so to speak. You're telling a story about this, but it actually means that. It's a parable. And it's not easily understood. The only way to understand it is if you pursue it with sincere interest. And so Jesus says to the disciples, it wasn't given to them like it's been given to you. The disciples had left their families, they had left their friends, to follow Christ. They had made a major sacrifice of their lives to become Christians and become trained as Holy Ghost ministers under Jesus's ministry. And Jesus said, these people out here, they have not done that. They are coming to be healed, to be delivered, and to hear the good news. And Jesus said to the disciples, it is given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. Why wasn't it given? That was the reason. The disciples had sacrificed to hear the gospel and be a part of the gospel and be trained as a gospel minister. And the people had not. They were just coming to the services, so to speak, to be healed or delivered. They had not done what the disciples did. And so Jesus said, you get to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And I speak to you plainly, but to them, I don't speak that way. I speak in parables. Now, why was he doing that? Jesus was trying to weed out the carnal Christians. And that's exactly what happens today. The Holy Spirit weeds out the carnal Christians, and he gives the anointing of Christ and the power of Christ and the gifts of the Spirit to those people who are God seekers. They're God seekers. And the parables were designed to weed out people who had a casual interest in God. Because if your interest in God was casual, you're not going to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You're not going to push it. You're just going to hear it and, well, that's an interesting story. I really can't figure it out. I got to go to lunch. Parables are designed to weed people out. They're not designed to give people specific divine revelations. They're designed to see who is motivated to understand the parable. The disciples didn't get information in parables because they had already sacrificed their lives. They had already given their lives, and they were already pursuing Christ. So he spoke plainly with them. Then Jesus says something interesting. Whoever has, to him will be given more. And he shall have more abundance. More abundance. Okay, so someone who has blessings from God and keeps pursuing God for more will receive more. You will go from abundance to more abundance. But people who are not God seekers, he says, whoever has not, from him shall be taken away even what little he does have. What are we talking about here? Motivation. Jesus said, therefore, I talk to them in parables. That's how I talk to them. And they see, but they don't see. They have ears, they don't hear. They have eyes, but they don't see. Why? Interest, desire, determination, and motivation. And then Jesus quotes the great prophet Isaiah. He says, by hearing you will not hear, and not understand, and by seeing you will not perceive. For these people, their hearts are hardened. They're dull. Their ears are dull. They can't hear. Their eyes, they have closed. Notice that? They closed them. Lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears. They should understand with their heart and be converted, then be healed. Notice that? The great pain, deception, and insanity of our evangelistic system, you take people like Greg Laurie, Billy Graham, Luis Palau, and the other big crusaders, is that the message they preach is a generalized one, trying to welcome as many people into the kingdom of God as possible. And so these systems are set up to make it easy to get saved. They make it easy to come to God. That's a big mistake. I do the exact opposite. I preach a nasty, filthy message of commitment and repentance. Because Jesus did the same thing with the parables. I weed out people who are not interested in healing and deliverance. I weed them out by preaching hardcore Christianity. In these crusades, they make being saved so easy that 80 to 90% of the people in all the crusades backslide within 6 months. They've done research on this, and it's been fully documented. They're gone. Why? Because you come down, you say a sinner's prayer, you fill out a card, you take the card and give it to the church in the person's geographic locale, and then hopefully they come to church, or you'll make a ministry call upon the family or that person. Then you get them to come to church on Sunday morning and Wednesday night Bible study, and they can maybe go to Sunday school and so on. And because these people are fall into the parable of the sower, some of the seed falls on the road, some of it falls over on some rocks, some of it falls in thorns, right? And they're gone. And that's exactly what big time evangelism does. It's great for proclamations, proclamating Christ as the King. That's great. It does a really good job with that, but it does a terrible job with getting people actually born again. And it does a hideous job with discipleship. See, what God wants to do is find out who's really interested in him. Here's why. 1,000 people who are casually interested in God are useless. One person sold out becomes a spiritual monster in the kingdom of God. The Holy Ghost can do more with one person filled with the Holy Ghost with burning desire for God than he can 1,000 other carnal Christians. So the Lord wants to work with people who are what? Yeah, they're absolutely dedicated. They're all in. Your prayers don't get answered, okay? No offense, because you are not all in. You grew up in the church system. After you got saved, you got into the church system. And the church system is a nightmare. It's loaded with carnal Christians and people who have no burning desire for God. They have no burning desire for God. Check out Jehovah here, 1 Chronicles 28. He's talking to Solomon. And he gets a prophetic word. My son Solomon, the Lord says, the God of your father, you must serve him with a perfect heart and a willing mind. For the Lord searches all hearts and understands all the imaginations and thoughts of the heart. And if you seek him, he will be found of you. But if you forsake him, he will cast you off. What happened to Solomon? Well, he got cast off. The demons took him. They outsmarted him. And remember, this was the most intelligent man that ever lived. Got completely smashed by demons. They completely outsmarted him. They turned him into a whore. He was a serial adulterer and a monumental failure. He's not even mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11, the Faith Hall of Fame. We don't even know if the guy went to heaven or not. Nothing about his fate is even mentioned. It's terrible. What happened there? Solomon started out perfect. He was aggressive. His desire was strong, and his pursuit of God was spectacular. But in his heart, it didn't last. It did not last. Check out Ecclesiastes chapter 1 here. The preacher says, I gave my heart to seek and search out by wisdom all things that are done under heaven. And this sore travail has God given to the sons of man to be exercised thereby. what's Solomon saying? Hey, God set up this system of answered prayer, miracles, signs, wonders, healings, deliverances, everything else, gifts of the Spirit. He set these things up, but they're only eligible for God seekers, people who will fight, pursue, and travail. The great prophet Jeremiah was a really interesting person. And he was a hardcore dude. And Jehovah said one time to him, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you an expected end. Tikva. Tikva is the Hebrew word. It means to fulfill your hopes and dreams. I want to do that for you, he says. But you shall call upon me and go pray to me, and I will hear you, and you will seek me, and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, saith the Lord, Yahweh. What's God telling you here? He's telling you something spectacular. He's telling you that a casual approach to Jesus will not work. It doesn't work that way. God can't be found that way. You can't get the anointing that way. You're not going to get miracles that way. You're not going to get answers to your prayers that way. Okay? You have to pursue it. Push it. You got a yellow streak on your back? You got to get that thing wiped off there. You got to wipe the yellow streak off your back. I'm going to say some really nasty words here. This is X-rated. Hold on to your seat. I hope you're sitting down. You're going to have to make some, here it comes, sacrifices. Where's my handgun? Okay. Please don't kill yourself because I said that. I know you're in a state of shock. You're going to have to make sacrifices. To find your destiny. You cannot casually get it. Dinner prayers don't work. Dear Jesus, please bless our food. Thank you for our gathering. Please bless and nourish our bodies in the name of Jesus. Thank you. Amen. No, okay. Bag it. Bag it. It's not going to work. That's good to bless a meal. That'll work. But you're looking for far more than a meal blessing. So you're looking to be used in the Spirit by the Holy Ghost. That's what you're looking for. That's what you want. You're not going to find it without making sacrifices. Jesus was unique, of course, from any human that's ever lived or ever will live. No one will ever attain what he attained. And the reason for that is he was able to sacrifice, 100% of his mind, his conscience, his soul, his spirit, and his body. 100% of it was turned over to his heavenly Father, Yahweh, Jehovah. 100% of it. Okay? No one ever did that before. No one ever did that since. Okay? That is our goal in life. That's our goal in life. It will never become a reality, but that's still our goal. That is our objective, to have the mind of Christ perfectly and to make a complete sacrifice to God. 100%. Okay, that sounds like bad news, and it kind of is. Here's the good news. You don't have to be at Jesus's level to have a staggering miracle ministry, and to get healed and delivered from demons. You do not have to have that level of commitment. Okay? You have to be a God seeker, a pursuer. Okay? Here, I'll prove it to you. In Matthew chapter 8, the dying leper came to Jesus and he was worshiping him. And he said, Lord, if you want to, you could make me clean. The Greek word for want to there is thalo. And that's exactly what it means. If you want to. I know you can, but do you want to? And Jesus said, thalo back, I want to be clean. But see how this miraculous miracle happened? His whole body was loaded with leprosy. He's going to die soon. Leprosy causes your digits to fall off. Your fingers fall off. Your toes fall off. It's a horrible disease. The skin necrophizes. I just made that term up. And it dies. Then it falls off your body. What happened? Oops. I just lost my finger. Can you imagine this guy loaded with leprosy, digits missing, instantly cleansed and healed? Imagine that. That was a supernatural miracle. It was mind-boggling. Correct? Sure it was. How did it happen, though? Well, it must have been something Jesus did. No. The Holy Spirit put that story in the New Testament. It's in Matthew 8, right? Why? Because this leper paid a severe price for this healing. He made sacrifices. Lepers were not allowed to live in the communities. They were in the Valley of the Lepers or some other place, caves, old sepulchers. They lived out of town. If they came into town, they could get stoned because it was a communicable disease and they could spread leprosy to the communities. Okay? A little bit like the COVID vaccine, kind of thinning the herd out, killing people. This guy sacrificed his health, his welfare, and his own life. Not to mention the difficulty he had getting to Jesus. He had to run him down, and he was physically ill. It's very difficult to go places and ambulate and go from one point to the other, obviously, if you are totally disabled. And you can see that because this man had the right stuff, so to speak, to steal from a movie, he got a miracle from God. And God was looking for people exactly like this dying leper. He wants you to be just like the dying leper. He didn't want you to have leprosy. He wants you to pursue and prioritize your life like this dying leper did. Is that amazing? Sure it is. That's why the story is in the Bible. The focus of the story is not the healing, it's the reaction of the leper to God. In that same chapter, you remember the story of the centurion, right? A centurion was a supervisor of 100 soldiers. And they were one section of a legion, 1/100th of a legion. And this centurion was a man of authority and power. And they lived in the communities in their own homes, and many of their soldiers lived near them in the communities. Yeah, so there were pockets of these Roman soldiers all over the place. Well, his son is dying, and the guy's panicking, and he hears about Jesus. And what was interesting about the centurion was he had a respect for Jehovah and probably attended synagogue services. He had a good reputation of the Jews, and in fact, the Bible says he had built a synagogue for the Jews because centurions, they were wealthy and they were well paid. They were very respected in the community, and they were very powerful. They had authority, left and right. And he came to Jesus, begging him, the Bible says. He was begging Jesus. He said, Lord, my son's laying at home. He's paralyzed. The Greek word is paralyticus. It means to have a spinal cord injury. He is grievously being tormented. Okay? This kid was being tormented severely by regrets and depression and hopelessness. The demons were attacking him left and right because he had been injured, probably in some kind of an accident, unforeseen accident, and he had damaged his spinal cord. Couldn't walk anymore. And immediately Jesus says, he looks up and he sees this centurion, and he knows this guy has made a major sacrifice to come to him. Because if you come to a Jewish rabbi in public, that was pretty significant. And he traveled some distance to get there. And Jesus saw the desperation in the guy's face, in his heart. And immediately Jesus says, oh, okay, this guy's met the qualification. He's a God seeker. He's sacrificed. He's overcome. He's pushing in. He's pushing it. No yellow streak on this guy's back. I will come and heal him. And the centurion says, wow, I don't need you to spend a day or so traveling to my house. In fact, if you come to my house, I'm not even worthy to have you come in my house. Okay, I am a person of authority. I give orders. They are followed to the letter. You are the Moshiach, the Messiah. The Greek word is Messias. You're the Moshiach. That's the Hebrew word for the Messiah. He knew about the Messiah. He respected the Jews. He understood Judaism to a degree. He had heard and been taught about the Messiah and realized that Jesus was in fact him. He saw it, saw the signs of the Messiah. It's in Isaiah. It couldn't be pointed out any better. He says, hey, you don't come to my house. You know, just speak the word where you are there. My son will be healed there. You speak it here, my son gets healed there. And Jesus was shocked. The Bible says he marveled. That's the Greek word thamazo. It means to be stunned. Jesus' jaw fell open. You're kidding. This guy's not even Jewish. Remember the story? It's in Matthew chapter 8. I hope you read it today. Jesus was flabbergasted. Flabbergasted, verse 10. And he looks over at the Jewish people standing around him. He says, hey, many of you will come from the east and the west to sit down with the father of faith, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, in the kingdom of heaven. He's looking around talking to him. But you're not going to make it. You're going to come there, but you're going to be cast into hell, it says. They shall be cast into outer darkness. There will be weeping, gnashing of teeth. Wow. Klaphmos is a Greek word for weeping there. It means to be wailing, not just shedding a few tears. When people go to hell, they don't shed a few tears. They're wailing in hell. Why? Because the Jews saw Jesus there, right? Bethany, Capernaum, you will all be brought down to hell. They saw the gospel. They saw all the miracles. They had exposure to all of God's blessings. They didn't do anything about it. You see that? You can see here now how going to church actually hurts you and does not help you. If you go to church and you hear truth and you don't apply that truth, it actually damages you by going to church. Yeah, because you are responsible for what you hear. Whoever has, more will be given, and you'll have even more abundance. But what little you have is going to be taken from you. You're going to lose that too. Why? It's all about attitude. It's all about your determination. It's all about what you're willing to sacrifice to receive the power of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. Unfortunately, I get prophets and seers come in for deliverance, and these people are so jacked up you can't even imagine it. If you're a prophet and a seer, wow, you may be having some serious problems in your future. The vast majority of prophets and seers in the United States are fake. They're loaded with familiar spirits and they're not real. And many of these prophets are out giving words to people. But if you look at their background, you'll notice that they're these enormously powerful spiritual people, but their lives are jacked up. Their personal life sucks. Things aren't going right. Their finances are jacked. Their health is jacked up. These people don't understand. They don't understand. They're being deceived. If you look at a true prophet of God, and there's very few of them out there, almost none, they have made enormous sacrifices, and they are humble, broken servants that you can spot a mile away. The prophets we got in the charismatic and the prophetic movement, these people are all partying and having a great spiritual time. They are not crushed, broken servants. You can spot them a mile away. It's so easy to do. These two healings give you an exact example of what God wants you to do. The two demon-possessed men of Gergesenus were in this chapter, Matthew chapter 8. And these guys got delivered from demons. They were what we would term in our language, SMIs. They're SMIs, severely mentally ill. And these guys both got delivered. Why? They came after Jesus. And it says in the Greek, kradzo, they were screaming at him, yelling at him for help. The two demonized men of Gergesenus got delivered. Why? They were God seekers. They were God seekers. And then later on, you'll notice, after they got delivered, half the town came out to see what was going on. They couldn't believe it. Everybody knew who these two psychos were. And when they got healed, people were in absolute state of shock. They came out to find out what was going on. That's good. Excuse me. That's the purpose of miracles, is to draw somebody to God. But guess what happened? Yeah, parable of the sower. They just faded off. They asked him to leave. They asked Jesus to leave because they were afraid. They didn't understand deliverance. They were scared. Remember the story about the boy on the cot? Yeah, that's in Matthew chapter 9. An incredible miracle. How'd that kid get healed? Well, the kid didn't do anything. He had paralyticus. He had a spinal cord injury. He couldn't walk. So his family and his loved ones put him on a stretcher, a cot. They brought him to Jesus. They couldn't get in because there was a mob there. So they, you know the story. They went up on the roof. They removed the tiling. Then they dropped down. There it goes. They dropped him down right in front of Jesus. Okay? Dust, dirt, tile, everything falling through the roof, clanging on the floor. Place a dirty mess. Everybody's oohing and aahing. They can't believe somebody's getting their roof torn up and somebody's being lowered through the ceiling. Okay? And back then, it was very common for people to have porches on their roof. In the United States, most porches are out at the front of the house. Back then, there were the porches were on the top, so that at night they could go out and look at the stars and relax and enjoy the night air. They would go up on the roof. Well, these guys climbed up on the roof with this paralyzed boy. And wow, they dropped him through the roof and it was a mess. Dust and dirt and tile falling everywhere. What happened there? The Bible says that Jesus saw their faith. Then he realized that the boy had emotional problems that were more damaging than his physical problems. So in this particular case, inner healing occurred first. And that's happened to me 100,000 times in my ministry. I have seen somebody physically healed after the inner healing took place first. I do it all the time. Jesus did it in this incident. And he told the kid, yeah, you're consumed with guilt and shame, but your sins are forgiven you. Can you imagine that? And everybody sitting around couldn't believe what Jesus said. They were stunned. And Jesus had the gift of knowledge running at maximum capacity, so he literally could, in a way, read their mind. And it says, Jesus, knowing their thoughts. The Greek word is idu. It means to see. He actually saw their thoughts, what they were thinking. And they were questioning his authority to forgive this kid's sins. Back then, people thought it was easier to get healed than forgiven. In our society now, the way we operate it, we think it's easier to get forgiven than it is to get healed. The thing's reversed now, flipped. And Jesus said, why are you thinking this evil in your hearts? The Greek word there is poneros, means perversion. Why are you perverting the truth in your hearts? He was reading their, he could see their thoughts. He said, what's easier for me to do, to forgive someone's sins or to heal them of a spinal cord injury? And just to prove his point, he told the boy to get up and go home. He did. He got up and picked up his cot and went home. Why? Because Jesus saw their faith. And they saw the relatives that had brought him, probably four of them, carrying each corner of the cot. And then the other relatives that went with them were just standing around watching. He saw how determined they were. He saw they had made sacrifices. He saw they were ready to go. And they had pushed their way in. They had pressed their way in. Guess what happened? The natural result of that, when you do that with God, is a miracle. It's a deliverance. It's a healing. You see, everybody who pursues God and steps out in their faith, it's routine for them to get miracles. Routine. Well, then why are prayers so difficult to answer? Why are there so few miracles? I just explained it to you. People do not pursue God with their whole heart. They want to be healed, and they want to be delivered from demons, and they want their mental illness to go away. But, they'd like to have it like a light switch. Click. Oh, it's all done. I'm healed. Can I get healed? And just flip the switch there. Click. I'm healed. I got bipolar, man. My brain's jacked up. Can you fix my brain for me? Here, fix it. Fix my brain. Click. Oh, it's fixed. That was the purpose of the parables, to weed out people who are not God seekers. They're not God seekers. Okay, I've been in this ministry for a long time, years and years and years. I have seen so many people not get delivered, you would not even believe it. And the pattern is always the same. They're not pushing it. They haven't prioritized their life. They're not making sacrifices. And they're not seeking the Lord with all their heart. You will seek me and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart, says the Lord, and I will be found of you. I have people all the time contact me, dozens of people a week. Hey, can I come in and get healed and delivered? Yeah. And then they come in and they're just busy with their lives. And they really want to just get better so they can go back to their lives. And they don't have a burning desire for God. And the ones that are healed, that God has extra mercy on, they later backslide and they go back into their sin. Or they're not serving God. That's why the parables screen people out. It's a filter. Okay, your disability, your demons, your sickness is filtering you out. Are you willing to make sacrifices to pursue God Almighty? In Matthew chapter 9, another miracle happens. Matthew, the tax collector, the Greek word is telonis. It means tax farmer. Tax farmers in Palestine were hated by Jews. They hated them. They took Jewish money and they skimmed off the top of it. Then they gave the money to the Romans. Can you imagine that? Handing the money, your money, over to somebody who hates you. Could have been a bigger insult. Well, telones, tax farmers, were despised in Israel, Jerusalem. They hated him. He was a perfect candidate for a superpowered Holy Ghost healing and deliverance ministry. Why? Because Matthew, before he came to Christ, was already accustomed to adversity and persecution. So the persecution of the gospel was not going to be a shock to him. He had been persecuted and hated from the first day he took that job as a tax collector. Made a lot of money, had a good life. But he had no friends. His family left him. He was miserable. But he understood persecution. And that asset became monumental later in his ministry after Jesus went back to heaven. He wrote this incredible gospel, the Gospel of Matthew. The thing is spectacular, say at least. Matthew sacrificed everything he had. You imagine that? He gave up his wealth. He gave up his home. He lived in a luxury house. He had a bunch of tax farmers who were friends of his. He left them. He made a major sacrifice in his life to become a disciple and later an apostle of the Lord Jesus. That's what God is saying to you. Hey, I got this gigantic rack of blessings that I want to give to you. And they got your name on them. Nobody else's. It's your name on all these blessings. But you haven't sacrificed. You haven't prioritized. You still got a coward streak on your back. Right? Paul talked about it. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. The Greek word for fear there is philia. It means cowardice. Should have been translated, God has not given us a spirit of cowardice. It's mistranslated, right? That was the context of the text too, by the way. He was talking about Timothy, who was starting to become a coward. He started to shrink back because of the persecution. And Paul was trying to get him to step up. God's going to take care of you. Fight back. No yellow streaks. And Matthew made an enormous sacrifice to God to become a disciple. It cost him everything. It cost him a lot of money. It cost him all his friends. When I came to God years ago, my youngest daughter, Tracy, led me to the Lord. I lost all my friends. All my secular friends. All gone. I didn't even associate with them anymore. I just left. I gave up my secular counseling practice. I was a millionaire. I had a six-figure income. You know, back in the early 90s, when a six-figure income, you know, was really a decent living. Nowadays, six-figure income is no big deal. Back then, hey, that was good money. I gave all that up. I let that stuff go because I saw the Holy Spirit moving, and I wanted a piece of Him. I wanted to see the Spirit of God help people. I've seen thousands of people delivered from demons. I've seen hundreds of people healed. Saw people healed last Friday night. It's on the video. And you can't get something from God if you're not willing to sacrifice for it. You know, here it is, Matthew 9, the woman with the issue of blood. She had cervix cancer. She had blood dripping out of her vagina. She was dying. She was broke. Okay, she had gone to Dr. Fauci and all the other doctors. He couldn't help her, of course. She was dying, and she exercised her faith through adversity. Faith through adversity gets miracles from God. The woman was dying. She was weak. She was sick. She pressed her way through the mob. She got to the street where Jesus was, and he was on top of her. He was right there. So she had to dive for that tassel. She said, if I can just touch the tassel, my cancer will be, the King James term is, stanched. Everybody needs a good stanching, I know that. And sure enough, she was healed. How'd she get healed? How did blind Bartimaeus get healed? How did the two blind men get healed? How did the woman with issue of blood get healed? How do these things work? How did the Apostle Paul become the greatest Christian that ever lived? They wiped the yellow streak off their back. They became God seekers. They became prioritizers. They became sacrificers. You will seek me and you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. And this is a hard message today, and in a way it's kind of depressing because everybody has their own life. You only have one life. You don't get two. Everybody has their life, and they want to do their own thing. They want to be, I just want to be me. Well, it takes a lot for a person to sacrifice their life and put God ahead of their spouse, their kids, their career, their own life. It's difficult to do. It's not easy. And that was the purpose of the parables. People who wanted an easy God got weeded out. And only the pursuers and the God seekers got through the parable, pursued understanding of what the parable was actually teaching, and went on to receive, quote, more abundance. And that's what God's calling you to. You cannot outgive God. If you give the Lord something, what? Your time, your energy, your love, your money, whatever it is. If you give that to God, you cannot outgive Him. He has so much more than we have. It's ridiculous. It's absurd. God's a good God, the Bible says. God is love, the Bible says. And you're going to reap what you can't even believe right now. But you have to sow determination. You got to sow effort. You have to overcome adversity. You got to push it. You got to kill this thing. If drugs, sex, and rock and roll are more important to you, you're done. It's over. You know what's going to happen to you? You're going to live a wasted life, like 98% of all Christians. They all live wasted Christian lives, 98% of them. Wasted lives. And they're born-again Christians. They're spirit-filled Christians who speak in tongues. Wasted lives. Why? Man, I just told you. God's looking for God-seekers, pushers, guys who will sacrifice, fighters. As they say in Spanish, Luca, you got to fight to win. And the more you have, if you will fight and sacrifice and pursue, you will have more abundance. If you live the life of a carnal Christian for the rest of your life, you're going to regret it for eternity, because on Judgment Day, at the judgment seat of Christ, you have to give an account of your Mickey Mouse Christian life. Man, that is bad. This is not good. No. Okay? And 2023 is the perfect time to reboot your life and start over. You have to do it, because your relatives are dying and going to hell. Your friends are dying and going to hell. Your family members are dying and going to hell. And the only hope they have is you. You're the only person that's willing to pursue God and figure out those parables. To pursue God and get your deliverance and your healing. I'll close with this then. The woman from Syria is a textbook example of what God wants you to be. The Holy Spirit put that story in the Bible to illustrate exactly what I'm teaching today. That woman pursued Jesus with a vengeance. Why? Mother's love. The highest love known to man in the human world is the love of a mother for a child. That's the number one love. And in this particular case, this mother loved her daughter like you can't even conceive or believe. She was killing it. And her daughter was chock full of demons. They were destroying her. They were physically destroying her. Probably had autism or something. She pursued Jesus with a vengeance. She hunted him down, had to find out where he was. Then after she got there, he wouldn't talk to her. So she kept following him. She asked the disciples for help. She explained her situation. They didn't care, because they were a typical church person. Most church people don't give a rat's fanny for anybody but themselves. And they wouldn't help her. And so she said, "Hey, I got news for you. I'm not leaving here until I get a miracle for my daughter, period." Does anybody understand this? Hello, my daughter gets a miracle, or it's my life. No in between. So she starts yelling, the Bible says. Anakrazo is the Greek word. It means to scream while you're yelling. That's what blind Bartimaeus did when he was sitting on the curb there. He started screaming while he was yelling. Anakrazo. And Jesus wouldn't listen to her. Why? The Holy Spirit wanted this story in the Bible for you. This story is for you. Yeah, this is for you. The disciples come to him. This will happen all the time. Church people will turn their back on you. They'll gripe about you. They'll tell you to shut up. Everything. You'll get crap from church people you won't believe. They don't understand your destiny. They don't understand your call. They're not going to support it. They don't get it. And the disciples didn't get it either. They didn't understand mother's love. They didn't understand the determination to get to God of this Syrian woman. She wasn't even Jewish. They didn't like her. Besides that, women were runts of their society. That's true to this day. If you go to the Middle East, women are second-class citizens. women have more rights in the United States than they have anywhere else in the entire world. I mean, back then, nothing. She didn't care. See, love causes you to go places nobody else will go. Love causes you to seek God when everybody else stops and takes it easy. So Jesus then said to her, "What do you want?" She said, "My daughter is grievously tormented by a demon, daimonium, the spirit's killing her." And Jesus said, "Well, wait a minute, you're not even Jewish. And deliverance is the children's bread. Deliverance is for Christians, not sinners." Listen, it's not proper for me to take the children's bread off the table and throw it to the puppies. We don't do that. The dogs eat the food at the table. We don't throw food down to the puppies. Kunarian is the Greek word, means puppies. He called her a puppy. It wasn't a derogatory term, it was a common term of the day. It was the class separations, class distinctions. And the woman says, "That's true, Lord. I'm with you. I understand that. But you got to remember something. The puppies, they eat the crumbs that fall from the bread on the master's table. The masters, the lords, they're eating the bread on the table, but sometimes crumbs fall on the floor, and sometimes the puppies get those crumbs. And I'm a puppy, and I'm underneath the table, but if you just speak the word only, like that centurion said, my daughter's delivered." He said, "Woman, great is your faith. Be it unto you as you want." Just like you want. The King James term is wilt, W-I-L-T, the same Greek word, phalo. You get it the way you want it. As soon as he said that, you know what she did? Same thing the centurion did. Boop, made an about face and headed home. When she got home, she found her daughter completely delivered from demons. Can you imagine that? How'd that happen? Well, she was a God seeker. She heard the parable, didn't understand it, but was determined to research it and figure it out and press her way in so she could have more abundance. More abundance. And that's what God's telling you today. Yeah. Who am I talking to right now on the podcast, on the Facebook, on the Twitch? Who am I talking to? A small percent of Christians will listen to this message and benefit from it. I already know that. I already know 98% of this message is going to go right in the toilet. That's okay with me. I'm looking for the 2%. 2%. 2% will say to themselves, "You know what? Most of my prayers are not answered. Yeah, you know, I don't see the signs, wonders, miracles, giftings. I am not in my destiny, and I need to be there, and this message is perfect for me. I got to become a God-seeking, fervent monster. I got to hunt Jesus down like the centurion and the Syrian mother. I got to hunt him down. If I can't see him, I got to yell to get him like blind Bartimaeus. I got to stalk him like the two blind men." God loves stalkers. You know what? He loves people who stalk him. He just loves it. The two blind men were stalking him. They both went home with perfect eyesight. 20/20 vision. Just like that. Bang. How about you? You ready? Okay. If you need further help, just send me an email. Mike@hardcorechristianity.com. I'll see you next Sunday on this podcast at 9 o'clock Mountain Time, 11 o'clock Eastern. Don't forget about my teaching service Friday nights at the Deliverance Center. And God wants to bless you and help you, and he's going to do it if you seek him with all your heart, if you become a God seeker, if you stop making excuses, if you stop whining, Nothing going right for me. Okay, you're done. You're finished. It's over for you. Okay? I'm not talking to you. I'm not talking to any people who make excuses. I'm not talking to whiners right now. I'm talking to God seekers, 2%. That's what our podcast was today. 2%ers. Let me ask you something. Are you a 2%er?